Hi, how are you? Welcome, good evening. I'm Michael Govan, director of the museum, and it's a pleasure to be here, especially to be talking with architect David Adjaye about his work in architecture and its intersection with communities. So thank you all for being here. We're also very pleased tonight here, our county supervisor, Mark Ridley-Thomas, is here with us. Supervisor Ridley-Thomas, very nice to have you at the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, my boss. And I just want to say this talk is part of a grant from LACMA's new California Arts Fund planning grant from the James Irvine Foundation. So we're grateful to them for the opportunity it provides us to bring people like David here to look at future ways of engaging people in their communities. And probably everyone here knows David. He was born in Tanzania, his parents from Ghana, and he has as eclectic a practice as an architect can have. He's been involved in music, art, science, cities, furniture. He studied at London South Bank University, earned an MA from the Royal College of Art, and in 2000 he founded his firm Adjaye Associates. He's won many prestigious commissions that you may know about, including the Nobel Peace Center in Oslo. We'll talk about some of these. And most recently, the Smithsonian's National Museum of African American History and Culture, which will open in 2016. His design for the Whitechapel Idea Store in London was a pioneering new approach to cultural space and information services. We'll talk about some of these projects. And he's collaborated with many artists, Olafur Eliasson at the Venice Biennale, and others we'll talk about. On September 19th, the Art Institute of Chicago is opening David Adjaye, which is an exhibition which is currently in Munich, at the Haus der Kunst, which really looks at his whole career. And that's curated by Okwi Nwizor, who is the curator of the Biennale this year. In particular, one of the things that's attracted me to David's work is the community-based projects, like the Sugar Hill development in Harlem for low-income and family and formerly homeless residents, which includes a preschool and a museum of children's art and storytelling. His libraries in London and also in the District of Columbia, which we'll take a look at, and the Stephen Lawrence Center in London that includes teaching in community space as well as Rivington Place. And I think no one more than David has thought about architecture's relationship to people and communities, and we'll have a little conversation about that. So please give a warm welcome to David Adjaye. Welcome, David.
Thank you.
So we're going to go through some slides and have a little conversation. But as I said before, I was hoping we could talk as much about your interesting architecture as about the ideas that formed them and also your approach to architecture. I think that so many people think of architecture as what something looks like. And we often talk about how it's engaged with ideas, with process. And so I'm hopeful we can have that discussion. Oh, did we? Okay. Well, I'll just, we may need to come back to this, but which was supposed to be at the end. But since we have the slide up, since it's so new, we'll come back at the end.
That's great.
This is the museum, the last building to be built on the mall, right?
Yeah, correct.
Which is your new when will it be open?
It'll finish the end of this year, but it'll open in May 2016.
Yep. So we'll come back to this at the end of the conversation. That's where you are today. Mm. And this is a little bit where you started.
It's more or less the first building I ever built. Yeah.
And this is 1999.
1999.
It's a residence, as you can clearly see from the gabled roof and the windows and the door and the picket fence in front of it. This is in London. This is before you made your many trips to Africa.
Yep.
It's in London. You were after you went to school in London.
Yes.
And this is the project that almost got you arrested, right?
Yes.
So I was wondering, because I've heard this story before, and this is a great moral tale about, you know, architecture that at first seems a little bit different. What happened when you proposed this to the to the commission that was commissioning this particular building?
Well, I mean, the clients were two artists, and they were amazing. So I was working with two artists who had no money, but a lot of ideas. And we wanted to make an architecture that was about trying to make a new reference to the city, a different kind of reference to the city that wasn't about the way the city code worked in its traditional sense, but would look at the sort of the post-war condition of the city and the historic conditions and try and make references. We in the end, you know, what's actually funny is that we deduced that the proportion of the panels we were using referred to the Georgian architecture. So we talked about a very soft sort of relationship to Georgian architecture through the panelization. And actually, it was almost exactly the same number.
The windows would have been exactly the same
exactly
size.
Exactly the same sizes.
I remember that.
Exactly. And the highlight you're seeing is this aluminium flashing just to make sure. When it kind of helps with the breathing of the system, but it also is a way of articulating the system. So it's a very soft relationship, but immediately, you know, the commission were horrified, of course. They thought that I was actually maybe insulting or doing something, vandalizing this important, because it's at the end of a historic street. But actually what I was saying was that the Victorian, so the sort of Victorian Georgian terraces that were there sort of had a complete composition. And I wanted to make an architecture that would not want to compete or add another form, but almost act as a full stop or a background. So I said, here was a situation where there's a full composition, and why does architecture always have to be the foreground? Why can't you make a strong piece of architecture that also plays a background role, but understands its context and its form, but is a kind of recessive system?
And this form in particular, it's dark on the outside, but of course there's quite a bit of light on the inside. I think we have slide of that. And what's interesting to me is that, having seen this building, is that it does actually fit beautifully into the neighborhood in ways that are unexpected. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I think recently there was a plan to tear it down for some practical reason of a new building.
Yes.
And the British architect Richard Rogers, who you may all know is involved in Centre Pompidou and many other things, he was the one who got you.
Yes. Well, I mean,
out of jail. Sort
absolutely.
Of.
I mean, I should explain the jail thing. I'm probably trying not to, but but essentially, my clients didn't have enough money. The facade was not approved by the council. We were still discussing it, and they had no home. We had to build it. They needed a place to stay, so we just built it, and technically, as an architect, I should never have allowed that to happen. So basically, I was going to be prosecuted. I'd been sort of brought up by the sort of building control officers. And, you know, I just started my career. This is my first building. It was published in Domus and everywhere. Everybody was talking about this radical new building, and I was going to go to jail.
so this is in the ask forgiveness, yeah, not permission category.
Exactly. And what was kind of great is Richard Rogers saw it in Domus and also realized that there was a young architect doing this. He wanted to meet me. I came and talked to him about the project. He saw the project. And basically, what's the great thing about peer help, as I call it, wrote an incredible letter to the city council and said, you cannot prosecute a young architect for making great architecture. You just can't do that. And you know, the job of the council is to understand this and to use it. So actually now the project, the council, you know, this is now 15 years later, use it as a reference to talk about contextualizing work, which is very funny for me because all the officers that were there are no longer there. It's a new team, but it's now the model reference. And now I'm actually working on a very large project right next to the site to rebuild the neighborhood, actually. It's hilarious.
And it's also an interesting case where if you had showed somebody the rendering of that ahead of time, you never would have gotten that.
No, it would not
built.
Have happened.
Yeah. And I say this so often that this idea of the new in architecture, it's so difficult to look at a rendering or proposal when so much thought goes into the three-dimensionality, the three-dimensional quality, the sort of feeling of a thing in space. Sometimes, I mean, I think in this case, that couldn't even be recognized until later.
Yeah, I always talk about this project, and it's a difficulty with a certain kind of work which is not obviously about a spectacular image or an image that is obvious to people as an illustration of what they think architecture is. When you draw, when you have to draw something which is recessive, but you're talking about something in the public realm, there's always this difficulty about the communication of it. But we are, you know, sentient beings in space. We kind of operate emotionally through space. So talking about light falling, a light fall shaft which kind of descends and drops light into a house that pulsates, talking about different luminosities in rainfall, not just sunshine, which is really, you know, 60-70% of London's weather. It's gray and dull, and talking about the kind of luminosities of that were really difficult to illustrate, almost impossible. They were really conceptual things that we had to discuss. And actually, only when the building was built did people really fully understand it and really appreciate it. And we'd have people just coming, and they'd want to just touch this wall. Yeah. It was the only wall in our, you know, that students would go and caress, and the residents became very nervous. The project that people would go and caress, which
yeah, it's a very loved building now, and it seems to feel like it was there appropriately forever. This is just the back of the building where the sense of light, and I think this idea—it's interesting to me how you've reversed expectations about light and dark. So this is a former industrial building that was turned into a residence, again, for artists, yeah. Correct?
Correct.
Where, and I've seen this building, and it seems almost impenetrably dark on the outside with this, like, smoked glass and dark. And, of course, at night it's a little bit different because you see this almost glowing halo, like a spaceship or something that's going to fly up. And I know that it's called the Dirty House, right? It's
Tim Noble, Sue Webster.
Yeah, Tim Noble and Sue Webster, two artists.
Yeah.
And I look at this house, and I was always thinking about that quality of mystery that you have, where it's a little bit impenetrable on the ground. And obviously, maybe this isn't appropriate for a public building.
No, this is a private home. This is a private home and studio.
Yeah. Right. So the idea is to give some sense of
it's this
privacy.
Idea, exactly. It's the, you know, in a way, the discussion in these sort of industrial parts of the city where a lot of artists and people were turning into residences was how do you make a retreat from the city? You know, in a way, the kind of the public, the factory building was a kind of open system. It was something about communicating with the city, but the home was a kind of an opportunity to kind of, if you look at the street, people are literally peering into your house as they walk the pavement. The sidewalk is so thin that, you know, and this was a kind of an area that was heavy with prostitution and drugs. And I mean, now it's a very sort of bougie area of London, and it's amazing how 15 years has transformed it. But I actually put the smoke glass is actually mirror glass, so that the sort of women of the night would use it for makeup and things like that. So it was a kind of response. It wasn't just a kind of it was a kind of slightly humorous response, but it was really a response, and it got used. In the early days, there'd be lipstick numbers, kind of like sort of scrolled on the windows that had to be polished every time. But in a way, this was an industrial building that this was my second building after the Electra House. And when we started working on this, the city said, "Oh, this is a horrible building. Tear it down. Build something shiny, new. Finally, build that building that you really wanted to do." And we said, no, the building we really want to do is to save this horrible sort of pile of stuff that you think is bad. And essentially what you're looking at is the sort of patchwork of, you know, the I call it kind of in praise of, very much in praise of the ordinary. It is the absolute banal and ordinary stock of the city. But we wanted to freeze it, almost kind of put it in an architectural sort of freezing point. There's a steel frame that surrounds it and holds it in place. And this is a resin coating that actually stops it being porous and stops water damage. And then what you're looking at is the top is a steel structure, which is exactly the shape of the volume. So it's a cube being and that sort of, you know, measured again by the form above, to talk about this regeneration. And what was interesting is that, again, I talked about this house wanting to go into the background, but actually it now became the sort of icon for this neighborhood. And in a way, in a very sort of matrix way, there's a kind of explosion of black buildings around it.
Yeah, that's actually, it's true. When you go back there now,
yeah,
black
it's totally
is
changed
in
the
now
entire
in
neighborhood. Yeah, it's become the sort of chic thing to do, which was not the intention. It was really meant to return.
When you're in this house, it's very California on top because it's all light and open.
Yes.
Right? Because that's the
It's a case study
space,
house almost on the
working
top.
Working space. It's what?
It's a case study house on the top.
And it glows so bright at night.
Yeah.
And I think it's interesting. I wanted to show some of these private houses because also one of the things that's interesting about your work is that so often patrons want an architect because of a style. And you're one of the very rare architects that seems to have no style. I mean, I think you must surprise your clients all the time because they're expecting one thing or they say, I like that house. And then, of course, you do something completely different, which we'll see. And
no, it's not to be, you know, contrary or anything. It's just for me, you know, I think the skill of architecture is something that you have to have. But for me, the ability to make something that resonates in the time is to test it within the context and to test it within the programs and to test it within the social context that we're in. And for me, that testing creates an innovation, which is not about a way of working, which is about a singularity that comes down, but a way of finding the forces which shape and give a precision to the architecture, which can't just come from the mind on its own. And it's this dialogue that I'm very interested in.
I also, you're also known as a little bit, you've used darkness, these dark skins.
Yeah.
It's been written about even in relation to your own beautiful dark skin, that these black houses are filled with light, like this house is. And you seem to have this incredible ability to frame light with this darkness, which I guess is something, I don't even know where you, like right out of the box, that was your
That was the way it started. You know, I think that I became very fascinated, you know, I think with modernism and generally with the modernist project of the early part of the 20th century, predominantly, there was a whole fascination with the reflection of light as the kind of way of making wellness and newness and modernity. And I think that actually what has happened is that the 20th century really played that architecture right to its zenith, really. It's kind of ended. And in a way, for me, the modern project is to always explore the things that we don't understand and not comfortable with. And for me, the framing of light and the way in which shadow works, which is explored very much in some Asian architecture, et cetera, but it's not really explored in the contemporary, became very fascinating to me. So what do we do when light is being absorbed? What do we do when light is being diffused so there is ambiguity? And how do we use that as a kind of force in architecture to create possibilities, social possibilities?
One of the things I've been fascinated by is in the response of the public to the plans we have out there for the Peter Zumthor building is there's this kind of immediate association of black with darkness,
which is the opposite,
when in fact
it's
usually
light.
The darkness that allows
you to see the light,
allows you to feel light.
About light science, you need you know, the reason why sports people put dark on their eyes and all those things is to allow you to see the light. And you know, if you put something bright in a very bright, high sort of luminous place, you basically can't see it, so you need to turn it down so that you can actually see the light.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think even in particular in LA, that came a little bit from Peter seeing light buildings that were sort of blinding, especially even at some other museums where you couldn't see as well. But you need to dim that to move the light, like an athlete with the black under the eye, to move that light away so that you can see. I mean, I've always been struck these houses in London, which is not known for its light, feel as luminous as California, which I guess.
Well, I mean, for me, what was interesting is that, yes, there is a sense also, I mean, it plays a lot with zenithal light. So there's a lot of, for me, I always said that the light in London is quite spectacular. It's not sunshine and bright, but it is diffuse. So it's the most beautiful diffuse light. So it's very hard to perceive it. But actually, when you capture it and let it fall, you start to see how extraordinary the kind of the richness of the range.
Yeah, and I think of so many, I mean, even like the Mises Berlin Pavilion is black because somehow the black, if you have a black fence, it disappears. Or if you have a light fence, you can't see through it. And there's that sense that black allows you to see darkness. Yeah.
I mean, I love that about the National Gallery, which I always refer to as well, that actually really Mies creates the cores and the cup and the three walls, and it's the plateau. And that actually the table just goes away when you look at it, and it's spectacular.
As this house is, with the light framed so beautifully from all sides too. That's what's nice. You get the way you've used side light, top light. I haven't been to the museum in Denver, as I said, but it seems like you use a lot of the same.
It's the same things applied into a public institution.
Tricks of light.
Yeah.
And there it is.
And
that's
not specially lit. That's basically the balustrade, and there's no lights in the ceiling. It's basically the terrace has a kind of low light and it reflects off the floor and bounces onto the ceiling like that.
So you were commissioned, you got this commission for the Nobel Center in Oslo. So this gets us to the point of where architecture should be changing the world, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where the Nobel Prize, so you have this must have been a very weighty
I was quite shocked. I mean, that was still when faxes were the way in which we sort of communicated, and we got a fax and we didn't believe it. We thought it was a prank, but we were asked to be in a competition with four other architects to imagine this new institution. And you know, the Nobel is very interesting because it is really a non-collecting institution. It is really a series. It's data, it's film, it's recordings, and it's of course these precious metals which are given. So it was how to turn this information into a 21st century experience for the visitor. People would turn up at the Nobel Institute, which was just an office, wanting to see something, and there'd be just a reception desk and nothing else. So this was the moment where this institution was born in the 21st century after 100 years of giving away this medal, and it was to try and use the experience of architecture. This was a building which was bombed very heavily by the Luftwaffe during the war. It was a sort of had an important memory in Norway. And so I wanted to make a series, what I said, instead of trying to kind of almost create a sort of a palace museum of artifacts, which there weren't, I said I wanted to make a set of experiences. So this was the first time to create a set of experiences. The first hoop is really a map of the world as a spatial condition. So instead of a ball, a panoptic relationship, it's a spatial relationship. So it's a map of the world surrounding you. You go through these different experiences through the space till you get to the heart of it, which was the first time, you know, working with MIT engineers, and this was before the iPad, and now, you know, people look at the images and think, oh, those are iPads, and I was like, no, this was before the iPad was made. We worked with a series of MIT engineers, David Small, an incredible guy, who basically developed the technology for allowing infrared to interact with you and scroll information, and he did a lot of work in the art community making digital books, etc., which is a lot of precursor to the stuff that we take for granted now. But he made, I said I wanted to make the Nobel Laureate field, instead of being a series of headshots hung in the air, high up in the air, it would be a digital garden. So we would make a garden where you would go in. So, you know, for instance, this is the area for the medal. So you actually, we made a brass chamber to put you into the moment of this golden, a sort of luster of having this gold, solid gold medal that's sort of put around you. And then, of course, the digital garden, which I'm talking about, you'll see in a second, is this kind of moment of this field with this, this landscape. And this was made in 2003, sort of way before iPads and things were made. And it was just basically this idea of coming to these screens, they would scroll to you. And we sort of said, oh, the future technology, you wouldn't even touch. You would just come to it, it would sense you, and then it would give you the information. And, you know, I'm still waiting for that. And I want to touch it.
So you got this commission. Yeah. It's interesting you talk about this map of the world. Yeah. You got this commission just after you had decided to start traveling to Africa.
Correct.
Systematically,
correct.
Right? And
correct.
You did it because you'd spent your time in school in London.
Yeah.
You went back to Africa, and if I remember, you did it systematically and geographically.
Correct.
And thought about a way to use geography as a way to, mapping,
correct.
Essentially, as a way to think.
Exactly.
And did this coincidentally fit nicely into that? Are these connected, this world, the idea of the map?
I think that it's no irony. I think that, you know, when I was doing it at the beginning, maybe not so consciously, but by halfway, it became the methodology for the practice. This way of mapping geography, understanding context, and looking at the world again became very important. And in a way, this project maybe summarized that kind of approach, and that was maybe the freshness that they were sort of seeing. But I systematically sort of divided the continent between Sanglophone, you know, Lusophone and, you know, Francophone worlds, and systematically looked across the geographies and wanted to remap the idea of cities, not through the lens of the political dimension, but through the way in which they respond or seem not to respond geographically. And actually what I found is that even when cities think they're not responding, they actually are, of course. They desperately respond, and culturally the shifts are happening. And then you see, when you erase the borders, the connections which are incredible in Central Africa or West Africa or North Africa. And in a way, I used Africa as a lens because it was a kind of a plate that hadn't had a lot of interrogation, so one could really kind of go to it and look at the information anew and start to form new associations. But in a way, it was a template for the way I wanted to think in the world.
If you haven't seen it, David did the most beautiful book of a kind of, it's an encyclopedia of African architecture, which is indexed by geography. And I think, as you once said, it's that all of those styles are without irony. They respond directly to the climate and geography. And yet
culture.
It seems like a source book of every kind of
building idea.
Yeah. I'm interested. You were born in Tanzania. Your father was from Ghana.
Yeah.
But he traveled. He was a diplomat,
yes.
Partly.
Yes.
And we're in this time when a lot of people are talking about a return to regionalism and a skepticism of globalism. So you've been a staunch defender of the complexity of globalism and of not wanting to give up that potential position of roaming, of moving things around. And I'm interested, do you get that pushback that in this world of, you know, it should be where it's from, vernacular architecture, and you're, you know, globetrotting, and as many architects do, making projects all over the world?
Yeah, I think that there's definitely a pushback against that. And it's, I think, a natural reaction to a sort of hedonistic period that we've been in. But I think that the attack is not necessarily against globalization. It's against this sort of attitude to the work. And I think that there's now a reframing of, you know, I mean, the classical period was all about, you know, work moving from the sort of Roman center to the edges. You know, you'd get the right architect, but there's always a translation and an adaptation. I always like to talk about that there's a translation that kind of understands how the work should respond in a different way. And I think that we've lost a bit of that notion of the response to a place. I mean, there's a really critical and very important discussion in architecture, which is that it's a kind of social emancipatory art form, and that actually to engage locally, but it's a human art form that requires a kind of understanding of the planet and how it's working at its kind of biggest scale. So yes, you can work locally and that's fine, but it contributes to a bigger knowledge. It's not just about the individual things. And you can practice at different scales where you're doing that, or you can practice at another scale when you're looking at the way in which the whole system is evolving. But it only works, I think, when it is tested against those conditions and when you evolve the ideas against those positions.
Right. I mean, it seems to me that in our world, it's almost required to think on both scales. Otherwise, you are thinking myopically, either if you're thinking entirely globally or entirely locally.
Yeah, and I think architecture, you know, I think there's kind of a dumbing down of architecture to just being a kind of building art. It is a building art, but it's also probably the greatest invention that humankind has ever made. You know, it's the moment when we made agriculture and realized that we could make cities. And this notion of the city, as you know, is the most abstract thing ever. It is the biggest separation from nature and the control of nature. But also it's the biggest organizing element, which has allowed us to become 9 billion people that we're going to become on this planet. It would never have happened up to 10,000 years ago. We were maybe a couple of hundred thousand, you know, people kind of roaming around. And then we explode in 10,000 years to what we are, and it's because of the phenomena of the city. So, and the phenomena of the city is this kind of mechanism which goes, it's tested in different regions and creates these incredible superstructures that kind of make us who we are. So to deny that evolution or to kind of just be in one bubble in it is really at a time when technology allows us to see the phenomenology of it and to learn the lessons very directly and to kind of cross-pollinate seems very naive, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I think it is. Today, it's the wonder of living is to be both extremely local at a moment.
Totally.
And yet have this sense of global. Yeah. It seems almost, I mean, it's so easy in Los Angeles because Los Angeles is the world. But mm-hmm. you think of it's so magical here to go into a precise locality. We're going to get him to move here if we can.
Apparently my office is moving here.
But it's this sense of like a precise locality of a corner where there's, you know, whatever, the signs are written in Hangul and Korean and it's as Korean as you can get at a moment. Yeah. And then you can move to another neighborhood or you can go to here. And I guess my idea about the cultural center or the museum is that potential to be both. And I know you've explored that in architecture, and I'm interested in how this is the Rivington Center.
Yep.
You've used cultural spaces and libraries, which are encyclopedias, right, of information, and how you approach that idea of because a library, a cultural center, is an encyclopedia for a locality and wants to engage the community, but in this larger global community. Is there a way to embed that in architecture for you?
No, for me, there is, and there has to be always. And this notion of sort of extraordinary precision, local precision, and a global outreach is absolutely the kind of operating standard of the 21st century. I mean, it's what's kind of great. You can be in the middle of nowhere, but actually be completely connected through all the mechanisms we know. But I mean, for me, the project of the public building or any public infrastructure or any cultural infrastructure was to also move it away from what it used to be in the city, which is a city where we had a kind of public life which then organized a certain kind of public ritual, which has been totally decimated by the post-war kind of remaking of the city, and we've sort of forgotten that that's been decimated. And to remake the public life again, one has to recapture the imagination of the public in terms of using public infrastructure. So it, for me, it is no longer the topology that's relevant, it's the way in which the program is brought into relevance using architecture within its context. So it no longer needs to be about high and low, it's about how you have impact, and you can work in any area to reactivate a public civic life. And the only way you can do it is, yes, you can do it through, you know, information and technology, but actually architecture is the primary agent that actually activates public life. It really is. We have public life through the internet, etc., but the physical engagement of it is through architecture. And there's nothing like architecture to remake the condition to allow a newness to appear. And it's this remaking that's actually critical to our discourse and to our project. It's why we keep making buildings. Otherwise, we should stop. But we need to keep remaking it because we keep rebooting the notion of what our public life is and what our cultural life should be. And we need to then see it. We need to physicalize it so that we can then move into that future. If we don't move into that future, I don't know what the hell the whole thing's about.
Well said. And this is actually Rivington Center, which was your first, I think, Oslo is more of
a sort of tourist
display center. Mm. This is one in a line of spaces that you've created to be community centers or gathering places
Correct.
For people to use architecture to almost create community, even of those who don't know each other
Correct.
To start with.
Yeah. It's very much the encounter, and it is very much the place where the encounter happens with the other. The libraries, which come after this, this is really a depository. This is the first real sort of working in the popular world, which was to remake the libraries for Tower Hamlets, and it was a competition that I won.
So this is Idea Store, another, sorry, there's just to say, Rivington Center, this is Idea Store, which has been hugely successful and I think was a next step. I mean, there's never been a space quite like this.
No, and this is in a brutalist sort of complex, post-war complex in London, which was seen as one of the most terrible neighborhoods to be in. Nobody wanted to go here. We won the competition because we said we wanted to propose a glass building in this context, which everybody said would never work. It would be destroyed in seconds. And we basically said our ambition was to make a center where young people would want to go more than Starbucks or McDonald's. It was that simple, and we just put it out there. We said, okay, we're going to make a building that is going to be much more attractive, and it's a public infrastructure funded by the city that would actually make it great for mothers or single mothers who had like kids, etc., to be able to have places to do their homework. It would be open till 11 o'clock at night. It would offer creche services. It would offer language services. There's about 15 languages spoken in this neighborhood. We said the notion of making the library was no longer just about an academic set of shelves. We've gone past that. It was about allowing people to engage information, to democratize knowledge, to democratize information, so that there was a sense that there are these places in the city that people could go and access things that they didn't understand about their world and feel comfortable about it. Yeah.
Is Idea Store your name, or was it already
It was actually the city who kind of did. And in fact, what's really ironic, this is the same city that tried to prosecute me. So, I, in the end, won their biggest library program.
Sometimes you really have to be out there a little bit to get that recognition.
Yeah, and just simple things. Like, I mean, this is now well known, but up till then, nobody had done a library shelf that was curved. And I came in and said, well, why do library shelves have to be curved? This is like, again, 2004. And, you know, it was just about this idea of turning the library into a landscape for people. And landscape is a very interesting metaphor that I always sometimes refer to. I don't like metaphors, but I like this notion of landscape because in a way it's a kind of hardwired intuition that everybody has, that if you refer to spatial relationships like landscapes, like going to a tree, going to a kind of vista, seeing over a view, looking at, it's amazing how actually culturally you can almost go across the entire spectrum. And so this idea of working with space as landscapes rather than codified systems of certain knowledge boxes actually opens up an ability to engage a lot of different complex kind of perceptions into a kind of commonality, to have a kind of common collective memory of a place that comes together from all the disparate differences.
Yep. I think of your library spaces, which some are formal libraries, some are like this, as being I mean, for me, they're real breakthroughs in thinking about, again, a world of knowledge, but then finding curved shelves, glass, transparency, interrelationships, the connection of people in unexpected ways, almost unexpected views. I very much think of the library projects as a lot of what the museum is, because it's many cultures, mm-hmm. pieces of knowledge, and to not think of it as a grid of categorization, mm-hmm. but to see it as an occasion of meeting, of ideas, in the same way it's a meeting of people, even things that are unexpected ideas.
Yeah.
And I think some of your libraries and these kinds of spaces have had that feeling of all the world of knowledge, but not in a rectilinear, Cartesian, absolute frame.
Yeah. I mean, if you go back, so this image, which I love, this photographer who took this, because in a way, when we were talking about this glass facade, people said, well, why glass? And I said, the one commonality that the community came under was these markets. There are these markets all over this area, which are green and white, or pink and white, or blue and white awnings. And it's the singularity of this place. And I dared myself to use something that which seemed loose and superficial, but actually completely embedded in the common memory of all the communities as a device to to expand up to an architecture. So sometimes the simple and the ruse, which might not seem worthy, might actually be the device, because it's the translation, not the thing, that's actually the game. And you know, it's almost like Laugier's kind of discussion about the kind of timber hut and the stone temple. I think that this is something that an architect needs to kind of remember, that actually sometimes the what seems rustic, and the rustic is the vernacular of the street, can be the temple.
Which it is in these cases. And of course, you've got knowledge and sales, and everything is intermixed in these particular environments.
So that, you know, you can do... These libraries became places where it's both, we started to have these discussions about body and mind. So they're places where you could elevate the mind and also exercise the body. So you can do dance, performances, yoga, there's teaching of, all the sort of body sciences, et cetera. So it's kind of extraordinary. And then you have a creche and all the child services. So it's looking after the child. The human body is a little thing. The human body is a kind of, adult. The human body as it grows older, as well as nourishing the mind, different people learning about different systems in a way.
So I love the fact that also you've chosen, in an era when I think everyone says, the library's dead because of the internet, you've seized on the library for a remaking.
For that reason. Yeah.
And is this you choosing libraries, or people seeking you out now?
No, I actually sought out the library, and I really was interested in this notion that somehow there is a kind of discussion that somehow architecture is superseded by technology. It's actually not true. It's absolutely reinforced by technology, and what the technology allows is a reframing of the architecture to be able to do more. Because now the architecture can perform more, because the wayfinding tool is technology for me, always. Technology is the wayfinding tool, and architecture is the hardware that kind of frames it. So every time the technology gets rebooted, actually it means you can be much more experimental with the system. In a way, this is in a very poor neighborhood in Washington that you'd never think you'd find, and we built it for the sort of a typical sort of library budget, and we built this building which playfully refers to this neighborhood is all hilly, and they have these stilted buildings and backyard buildings that people have, sort of suburban houses which are very beautiful, but on the back they built these boxes with stilts. And I was really kind of taken by this stilt architecture in the backs of these houses, which nobody wanted to talk about. But so I made the presentation about their neighborhood. We photograph very incessantly. I have sort of three social scientists that work with me, so we kind of mine the places that we go into. And then we sort of replayed the neighborhood back to the community and said, well, look at the diversity in your space. It's not really about the kind of fronts of the buildings, but it's also about the backs that you live in. It's also about the neighborhoods. And look at this architecture which responds to this space. So why can't we do something? This was south-facing, so I suggested that if we elevated it, this could be a kind of fantastic public community space. And now it's used for car boot sales, it's used for education sort of meetings, they have performances under the library, and this is the public library. So the porch of the library is activated as a kind of outdoor, indoor room.
And I was there. I saw so many people at this library. I think it was there on a Saturday, and it was just full of people. There was something happening outside. Mm. Obviously, these architectural pictures show it.
With empty, sorry.
Emptiness. This is the architectural record version of that photograph.
But this is a real moment.
This is Phil. And what's hard to capture in any of the photographs here is how experiential this and the other library is in terms of chance vistas of other people, sometimes through colored glass. This may, I don't know if this is a green glass or a green wall, but there are, people seem to be framed like paintings. There seems to be a lot of this idea of seeing people as well as books, computers.
Yeah.
It does seem like it's made for community.
It's completely made for community, and in a way, I'm always fascinated by this idea of the framing of the ordinary, because what architecture is great at is when you make an aperture or frame to the ordinary, people see themselves differently through the frame, and it's actually really important to allow that to happen, because in a way, the ordinary life of a citizen is very rarely framed. The frame is always something special. Something that they see that's other. But actually to frame the ordinary also kind of creates a sort of interesting sort of paradox, which I think is very important. I mean, whatever I'm framing, I'm usually also framing light as a thing. And for me, you know, the notion of geography and place is about trying to kind of sense the quality of light of your region or your place. And so capturing it in light wells or capturing it in systems that allow you to see the physical light is very important to me. And it's almost a sort of the real primary material. If there's a style, that's probably the style that's kind of coming through the work.
Well, and I also notice so many architects think you think of glass as being an exterior material. And especially in these libraries, you've used glass as the primary interior material,
correct.
Reflective glass, colored glass, so that you see yourself as you're seeing others. It's like a play
kaleidoscope.
Of mirrors.
Yeah. It is a kaleidoscope. It's not a sort of fascination of transparency for its own sake, but it's the ability for me, glass to kind of perform acoustically, but to also have visual relationships, but also its ability to distort landscape or to kind of reflect it to you in a new way and to give you a new kind of frame is also very important.
I was also surprised at in such a small space, it's like you take little journeys inside the space into areas. I when I got out, it just seemed like the building couldn't be that small because I had had all these experiences walking in and around and finding spaces. So you've made this, I don't know, sort of adventure. It's almost for kids, but for kids who are adults well.
The building very much unfolds. I always say that the buildings have narratives in their section, in the way in which they unfold. They don't just present one system. They have a kind of way in which you kind of experience them, and you can follow that formally or not. But it does unfold, and usually what I'm trying to do is that in that unfolding, I'm also speaking about the place, because what I'm doing is placing you at vantage points to either see a particular view, placing you at a moment to see a certain sight line, rotating you to see a certain historical context. It's something that I do all the time, and it comes full circle in the museum on the Mall, where it's a register of the place.
I'm curious as to how in the world you get these things built in these tiny budgets of public projects and public libraries, which most architects don't even want to touch because they're
you don't
so
earn money from these, FYI.
Diminutive, huh?
You don't earn money from these. So if that's the motivation, that's not what you're doing.
I know, and you've made that part of your practice.
Yeah,
these
very much.
Money losing, beautiful libraries.
Yes.
But I don't even know how you get it built. From a construction standpoint, do you have a secret to that you figured out?
There is no magic trick, but we are actually extremely precise about construction, and we're very precise about the way in which we approach construction. So we don't just draw and hope that a contractor will tell us how it works. We actually have a series of systems that we kind of go through. We're always testing what we think we want to achieve and how we want to achieve it. So framing construction is very important in this project, so that you're not spending a lot of time sort of going backwards and forwards. So I mean, for instance, the inside of this building, which was the outside was that view, the inside is just very ordinary concrete shuttering plywood, but it's just lacquered. So when we told the builder again, no, it's the really bad plywood that you're going to buy. And they couldn't handle it. They wanted it to be walnut. They showed us lots of samples of mahogany ones. We said, no, it's got to be the shuttering plywood. And in the end, they got it. You know, the concrete on the floor has a dye in it. It's just basically, a sort of chocolate-dyed concrete. Some of the critical things are the way in which it's the structure is set up. We're really very precise about structure and what the structure is going to do in terms of cantilevers, et cetera. This is held on two moments, and it's a sort of very large cantilever. You know, that we spent a lot of time kind of working through that, and then that gave us the device to then kind of augment the sort of systems on the inside.
From all the buildings I've seen, it seems like you have the most fun with libraries. There's a sense of humor that I see in some of these buildings.
Humor is important to me, and not humor, and maybe I learned that from, I spent a lot of time with Eduardo Sutsumura and Eduardo always talks about humor in architecture, and probably I've taken that from him, that actually in architecture, there is the seriousness of the thing, but also there's a way in which you kind of almost open the jacket. you don't try too hard to just be strict. That sometimes, and I think in public projects, it's very nice to let the public feel moments where you sort of reveal it. You sort of let it go. But maybe it's perverse. But for instance, this little box is for children to sleep in, but you see you're at the eye height of a certain tree. And it's totally idiosyncratic, but actually when kids are in it, they get it, and they see the birds at a certain point. But, you know, it doesn't make sense when you're talking about it in a certain way. Or there's certain windows which are so low, you know, they're 1.2 meters, and so the adults are like, why are we doing that? But actually, a child standing next to it. You know, it's these moments are very important. Or you open a piece of construction, you know, you show the way something comes together, but instead of actually sealing it, you just open it, and you see all the layers. So there are these moments which I think can be internal, but actually also very important to kind of humanizing construction, to humanize construction, not to mystify it. Yeah.
I didn't get to sit in this space because there was an adult sitting there when I was there, so it's not just children, adults. I can tell you, even though it was the children's section.
It's a children's
somebody
library.
Somebody had figured out that was the great hangout space. It was during school hours, so I guess there weren't that many kids there. Well, we should actually, in the interest of time, is another artist's house.
Yeah, and my first project in the U.S., really. Yeah.
Right. Mm. Which is also about light. You have this dark shell, lightness on the inside, and it seems to hold that light.
Mm. This one really frames that Brooklyn sort of backyards, you know, in a Hopper-esque way, and it's just this idea of the framing of Brooklyn. It's in Brooklyn.
Very classical.
I can do classical.
Again, it doesn't look like anything else exactly. It seems black and white for private spaces, color for public spaces.
Well, it probably comes across that way, but it's not deliberate. I've actually done private houses, which are like also very rich color, like the Lost House is a riot of color. It just depends.
All right, well, this is a living space that's without so much color, just recently finished in New York, in Harlem, Sugar Hill, and a public housing project, one where there was a de minimis budget,
but
somehow you tried to squeeze out every
drop
penny.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the reward from that, you actually got a lot of criticism, or this building got a lot of criticism because people said, well, why do you want to spend all that money on architecture when you would have had more space if you'd built a rectangle?
Yeah, and the irony of it all is that we couldn't build any more volume than this.
Right.
And this is the same budget as a kind of brick sort of project housing that you would see anywhere. It's the standard budget. And what we did was we absolutely did maximize the volume. We went to all the code issues. You know, people said, well, you can have big windows. Well, it's actually, there's some code issues that actually stop you doing certain things in this kind of housing. And this is housing for homeless people. So this is a home for homeless and the lowest sort of income run. It's 125 units. And we worked with the community, the social housing group that actually do this to bring a storytelling museum in. There's a storytelling museum which is just finishing this May. There's a creche for 125 kids. There's a whole public infrastructure which has these large public rooms for birthdays, bar mitzvahs, whatever you need. And we also worked with Amanda Burden, and this is just the initiative of us with the client to put an urban farm on the roof. It'll be one of the first housing projects which will have an urban farm for the community in the building.
Yeah, and it's super successful. I think the project's super successful, and I know you had to make compromises. I know there were things that you wish you could have had, but for code reasons, or probably more for code than for cost.
The code was, we had to. There's a certain type of window that you can use, and it was really a big fight. We tried to get them bigger and bigger, and we couldn't get them any bigger. And the light levels are fine. We just wanted them bigger, but we couldn't do it.
So, but it's a huge success, and I want to know how we can figure out. How to convey the importance in our world of architecture and ideas to projects like this, because we live in this pragmatic society where the usual American or government responses will just make it as simple and cost-effective as possible. And then we talk about sustainability and efficiency as high-level achievements.
Yep.
And somehow in these cases, we don't see architecture or design in that same sense. And I always think of this design, that these ideas that you've put in, as making the building more sustainable and more efficient somehow, because they make the building distinctive. You know where you live. Mm-hmm. You know where to go rather than just empty blocks. Do you think that is a growing consciousness? I know in New York there seems to be a little bit more
a
shift towards design, even in the lowest cost projects.
Yeah. No, I think that finally people are realizing that the sort of sustainability, that word which is overused and most people don't understand what it means anymore, is actually about the entire life cycle. And design is a critical component of the actual sustainability, and the sustainability is also to do with the kind of the wellness of the user in the building and the sense of ownership that the builder, the person who has that has. It's not just the empirical ticking of the boxes. And what's kind of interesting to me is that we have emails from people who live in the building who just talk about how proud they are to be in this building and what it shows them, what it reveals, the kind of meetings that they have with certain people in the sort of either in the museum or in the lobby or where they go to. And this idea that somehow the architecture has kind of in a way curated a possibility rather than sort of just made the most efficient core and the most kind of minimal system. It's created opportunities of encounter throughout the entire thing, and it allowed them to kind of have a sort of richness which is to do with the cosmopolitanization of just seeing the other and being able to kind of encounter the other beyond the pragmatic. So I'm it is highly sustainable. It has all the insulation values. It's it's a gold LEEDs building. So it's actually one of the, it's one of the first housing, New York has a few of those, but it's for low-income housing. It's a gold LEEDs building with using the same sort of benchmarks. But it also is, for me, the form, the masonry, it didn't also just come out of nowhere. It actually came from understanding this is Sugar Hill Harlem, which was a very important part of the Harlem Renaissance. So this is, Duke Ellington used to park his car on the site, which I kind of completely, made me want to kiss the ground when I got there. But so this is Duke's car park, Malcolm X is around the corner. It was just, so there was a kind of whole game about the facade and masonry and this idea of, that part of Harlem is also the highest part of Manhattan and it overlooks the city. And this notion of this is where you went if you wanted to get out of the slums. It was the sweet part of Harlem. They call it Sweet Sugar Hill because it was about this place where you get incredible air. And there were these beautiful farms and there were these beautiful rose gardens up in this area. So the whole building is about this memory of the rose, the Harlem Rose. So it's about this building which is embossed with this Harlem Rose motif, which is, but the close-up, the facade basically and it's deliberately not obvious because it basically, depending on the light angle and the sun angle, it pops. Or when you have direct sunlight, it disappears. And it's the idea that it's an environmental ornament that appears and disappears. And it's really just using a vector system and a form liner that's sort of set up a certain way so that in the rain, it's very visible. In super bright light, it disappears. When it's a long shadow, it appears. And so the idea of the building unfolds itself to the user in very different ways. It's not something that's static and
I saw it once in the rain, and it was very vivid. Prominent, yeah. But it wasn't even finished yet, yeah. The building. Yeah. And it's fantastic how that works.
Yeah.
So other than the very large amounts of money you make from these projects,
yes, vast amounts.
What is it that drives you to seek these projects out? A lot of architecture offices have a percentage of work they will do in public housing, mm-hmm. or other spaces.
Yeah.
It seems like you aggressively go after
these
low-budget, yeah. libraries, housing projects. It must give you more than the big commissions.
Yeah, no, it's not about the economics, and to the point that actually, I nearly lost my business a couple of times. So it's not without high risk. But I am very interested in this notion of the social contract between architecture and society and public work, and the rediscovery of public architecture, in a fast commercializing world, which is really privatizing really fast. And, how do we make relevant public architecture is for me a very important 21st century question. And for me, if we've lost the realm of making incredible spaces, which are, difficult to do, the infrastructure that we build can no longer, for me, just be about interior systems, but in a way they kind of become much more than that. They become places of encounter and meeting whenever there's public, and how we generate that in architecture becomes very, very paramount. That every square sort of foot of space that is about public should have the same intensity as what Olmsted was trying to do with parks for people. It should have that generosity. As a kind of a public right, as a public contract, because we're losing so much of it. So every one of those moments is really precious. Does it give you a view to something? Does it teach you about something in your place? Does it give you a kind of new way of seeing the world?
And is it a freedom not to have to fuss with picking the finest materials, but rather deal with a vocabulary of things are within reach so that you can immediately focus on the shape of things? I think about how a sculptor or an artist would use the lowest materials, which in architecture somehow isn't as much allowed.
No, it doesn't seem to be allowed. For me, I completely embrace that strategy because of this notion of the concept being a very important part of what the architecture is. Yes, we're completely committed to construction, so it's not a loose sketch, but it is about not making architecture about just the three noble materials of stone, bronze, and glass. As beautiful as they are, let's not knock it. But
I also love the ease with which, this is a slide from the housing project.
This is the museum.
With part. Which it looks exactly the same as the high-end London gallery of Marion Goodman's.
This is the most expensive gallery.
Which is the most expensive gallery in London. And I love that it looks almost exactly the same. So somehow you've been able to translate that simplicity, because I was in this gallery recently and it's stunningly simple.
It's very reduced.
You left the raw materials of the staircases, yeah. and things open of the old building, yeah. so that the, as much of the old windows and casings, so that it looks as simple as yeah. that, which must be something you've learned.
It's
from the low budgets,
correct,
to go to this.
Yeah, and this is the Richter show, and in a way, what is interesting about this project is that we learned to remove. There are no ducts that you can see. There are no systems, or you see the lights, which are the sort of insistence of the artist. So you can have two different systems. You can have this or spotlights, and what you get is just daylight and wall. And it's really a way to move all the infrastructure from the floor and the ceiling and to actually conceal it into the walls. So the service systems are the walls, which make this primary form and distribute air by shifting forward or backwards from the historic building. So the relationship to the historic building, so it looks deceptively simple, but it's technically an extraordinary piece of engineering and work that I'm really proud of.
Yeah, it's very beautiful. There are also some nice bookshelves in that building. And now for something completely different. I just wanted to show a few, in case people had not seen these, artist collaborations. This is Chris Ofili at the 2003 Venice Biennale. Which was much remarked upon in terms of the light. And this is a true collaboration, right? This
yes.
is not your color scheme.
No, this is Chris's color scheme and me working with him too. Chris wanted to make a piece of architecture like a painting. That was yeah. his brief to me. Can you make that painting into a piece of architecture? And I said, sure.
Which you did, because
yeah.
if you see the ceiling.
Yeah, it's literally the celestial body in the paintings that's
right.
been made as this vault, and they're all suspended, all the glasses held off this sort of morose superstructure, and they're all just cantilevered down, these shards of glass.
one of the most extravagant frames I've ever seen for a painting. And just to compare that, well, in here is also the building as a painting, to the utterly monochrome and simple building that has very little, no glass that you see on the exterior. And this was done with Olafur Eliasson, first at the Venice Biennale, and now I've not seen this.
It's permanently installed in Croatia on the island of Lopud.
Okay.
And so it's the cheapest building I've ever made. It's made
plywood?
Out of shuttering ply, bituminous paper, and pine. And it's now, it was supposed to be temporary, it's now permanent. So we're looking at ways to keep
it there and hope
permanent.
It lasts.
But essentially, it's a, you know, it's Olafur's project, The Black Horizon, about splitting light. So I made a piece of architecture that splits the light. It faces the south, splits the light, and slows you down to see his horizon light line.
So this is inside, and this again is a collaboration with Olafur Eliasson, where you come up through that space of light from the outside, gradually darkening until you're in this interior, and then there's a horizon of light, the thinnest line that seems almost, I mean, super.
Yeah, it's 3 millimeters.
Hi-fi. It's high-tech.
3 millimeters, and the light coming out is the same as the daylight outside. It's calibrated. So if you compress the daylight to 3 millimeters, it would burn like this incredible.
Yeah, it's as if to flatten the sun.
Yes.
Of the outside into a line.
A line of light. Yeah.
Which is an extraordinary thing. And of course, almost no architecture, but also the perfect architecture to hold it. Now, I haven't seen this. This is in China?
This is actually in Korea. And this is a library, a public library it's basically an outdoor library. And it's a new project. Again, it's the Gwangju Biennial.
Oh, right.
Yeah, and it's basically, you know, the kind of incredible literature and sort of reading culture in Korea. So basically the base is an exchange which is run by the public library program where people bring books, and the library has, I worked with Taya Selassie, the writer, chose 200 books about the sort of history of South Korea's kind of revolution and the democratic movement. And now it's become this place where, you know, there's performance, Wi-Fi, etc. But it's by the river and it floods. And what it is that the datum that you're seeing is concrete that is floodable and submersible. And the upper structure is this timber louvered thing, which kind of deals with shade. So in the high tide, you use the upper level, and in the low tide, you use the entire structure. But it's an open. It's almost like a sort of a monument to democracy, but it's also a kind of a public library exchange.
And that's on the upper.
That's the upper level. Yeah.
And two more projects I wanted to show. So I have not seen this either, but this is the school in Moscow, which is the largest project you've ever undertaken.
Yeah.
This was an effort to put a building in a park to revitalize an otherwise not particularly interesting area of town.
Yeah.
And now it has caused tremendous growth, economic impact, other museums, culture spaces. Businesses.
Yeah, it's a sort of interesting project. It was a competition to build to rezone an area of Moscow to become the new sort of Silicon Valley for Moscow. But to build, you know, this project was to build. It was a public-private partnership to build the management space. It's their Harvard Business School or their INSEAD. We won the competition, the biggest competition. It's a 600,000 square foot building. We had to build it in 4 years, sort of minus 30 snow to summer. Basically developed a sort of city, a building like a city campus with Olympic pools, you know, 3,000-seater auditorium, gymnasiums, et cetera. But I was very inspired by Melnikov, very inspired by this context. You can see the Melnikov reference. This is the studio, right? This is the artist studio of Melnikov, right?
Right.
But giant. This idea of a kind of a city building, which is the first building before other buildings come. So in a way, the forms that are splitting, what it is, it's basically a compass. The forms point to the east, west, north, south. And so it's a sundial that's been placed in this 27-acre park before the architecture comes. And so I just wanted to make a compass before the city comes that orientates you. So essentially, that's the first moment. And so it's the first time that I've been allowed to make an architecture before the architecture comes. And so how could I make something when there was no reference? I didn't want to just make reference to a landscape because that was going to go. But it was to anticipate the city that's coming. And that's the building in its context in the winter.
Amazing. So I hope to see this in the summer.
Yes, when you come to Dasha's opening.
And I want to end talking about the project in Washington, which was very controversial to take the last space on the mall. It was a big competition. You want it still in process, it's under construction. And it also took a very, I think, unusual radical stance toward its environment, which again is a maybe at first glance doesn't seem to fit, or that was the criticism, yep. Because for one, you used metal. So this is a close-up of the facade. We saw the very first slide I showed was the outside of the proposed museum for being built.
Correct.
And you chose this metal facade, and I know the story behind this, but I wondered if you could talk a little about it, because it's both an engineering and technical achievement. Mm-hmm. It seems to go against all the other neoclassical architecture of the mall, even the modern architecture, mm-hmm. and yet somehow I feel like that very first house, that it's going to fit in more beautifully. But I wonder if you could talk a little bit. I just love the story about how you came to this material and these patterns that become the facade of this building.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the patterns, you know, the first form, the silhouette, this idea was to make a museum where the narrative of the museum is signaled even before you reach it. So it's not a neoclassical palace that sort of sets up, but it's a new form where the silhouette is very important, that the silhouette lets you know that this is a new kind of public infrastructure. Then two, and there was a reference to, the African-American community comes predominantly from Central and West Africa. And so they come from the forest region, and it's a reference to a very important sculpture that was a sort of shrine head thing that I became very fascinated with, which was found in Yoruba temples. The second thing was this notion of Charleston and Louisiana, and the notion of the guilds of the African American community when they were freed from slavery. And you know, the three things that were immediate guilds that they went into were, you know, the woodworking industry, the metalworking industry, and the army. These are the three first professions that were unanimous almost. And the metalworking industry is interesting because in a way the African Americans built most of the South in terms of, and actually Washington. And we wanted to honor that and make that connection to the bronze work of West Africa and the metal work of the South of America and the sort of African American hands that have been kind of forging these incredible traditions. So I took a very typical Charleston facade, which we think was built by slaves, and we set up an algorithm to remap the way in which the acanthus leaves intersected with the kind of rigid orthogonal structures. And that mapping created this pattern. So we sort of grafted a DNA out of the system to create a new DNA. And we did it because this system basically is the environmental shield for the project. It gets thicker and thin, as you saw in the drawings, to do with the orientation. And so in the north, it's incredibly transparent. It's 65% transparent. In the south, it's right down to 75 or 80%. To shut down the light, and it creates this light box which filters light in very different ways, but also is the circulation system. So instead of a traditional museum where you actually have, you come into an atrium or something and you go in, you come to the perimeter and you circulate up and down. You go down into the sort of basements, you rise up into the top of the building, and you always circulate in this gauze, getting moments and vistas to the view, but also kind of being dappled in this orientation of light. You understand south light, west light, east light, north light.
And it's the majority of even the facade of the building,
yes,
right?
Yes, it's more than, it's the only, the clear moment is the base, which is a 210-foot public room that you come into, which is this. And it's the moment with a forest, what we call a sort of memory of the forest. So there's basically a sort of reverse, sort of what I call the petrified forest. So really, it's this idea of a kind of a reference to the forest region, which is where the African American community come from. So how to make a kind of reference without literally making it? It's also a device which acts as a sort of acoustic and environmental sort of buffer to this glass room, which basically looks at the four lights. It looks at the four cardinal directions. It's orientated perfectly. And then from there, you rise into the corona, which dapples the light. And then in a way, that's also a light register to reduce your retina before you go into the exhibition spaces, which are darker. So it's this system of light gradations. And then from there, you kind of have these punctures to the mall, to the, you know, to the White House, to the Capitol. You're orientated. It's also a kind of orientation tower.
I'm interested. I know there's been a lot of controversy about the look of this building. Mm. But again, one of the things is that and I don't want to say it's chance, but there's a little bit of this process of remapping, redoing, rethinking, new materials. There is a bit of risk taking, right? No one knows what a building looks like on that scale.
No.
It's not until it's built.
Yep.
And so I guess you have to ask for a little bit of patience from the whole community as well as yourself.
Yeah. No, and I think that, you know, the art of architecture is to allow that invention to happen. And, you know, when we put this, when we made the proposal to the Fine Arts Commission, they were, you know, they said, well, why bronze on an incredible, you know, sort of boulevard of stone buildings? And we said, well, actually, there's stone, but there's also metal. The metal are the roofs. The metal is the signature of certain places. And the metal is actually the monuments that are actually cast in bronze along the mall. But there, you see them as monuments. And we said that we're next to the most important monument, Washington's Monument. So we were an architecture which was between the architecture and the monument, blurring between the two. So we said that actually we didn't want to necessarily specifically be about the architecture nor the monument, but somewhere between the two, making us a full, I always say my building is a full stop to the run of palaces and a way to orientate yourself to the Washington Memorial grounds. It's a junction, it's a knuckle. So the knuckle can't be the same as the stone, and that won the argument.
It also seems like a knuckle to history and community. I think of this as being one of the most exciting projects in the United States right now, in the sense of how it challenges Washington. And I think like that first facade of that house fits in perfectly, will fit in perfectly with time.
Thank you.
Only time will tell. And I think that is this other thing about architecture. You can put your heart and soul and ideas in it. And I constantly have to, you know, describe that idea that it, you know, what it looks like will emerge and time will tell if it's lasting. Yeah. But all, as you can see, all this thought goes into it, and I rarely see such thought about the playfulness, the history, and community as I've seen in your work. And I just want to say thank you for all of that.
Thank you, Michael.
And anyway, thank you for this tour of your architecture. And maybe there are, you okay with a couple of questions? And maybe if there are a couple of questions, that would be great.
Yeah, I mean, none of these projects are unique budgets. One, this is not a sort of none of them are about sort of getting a special moment. They are the ordinary budgets for making libraries, the ordinary budgets for making schools. It's what is shifting is the thought and the way in which you are sort of working those things. This notion of a kind of gentrification architecture that causes a gentrification that goes away usually happens in the commercial sector. It's very rare that it actually happens in the public sector. In fact, usually when the public sector happens, when it's a public sector project, which is what I'm always very interested in, it supports those impoverished communities where you have negative equity, et cetera. We're working on a project in Newark right now where, you know, there's a power station exchange that's coming, and we've been brought in to develop something specific to a neighborhood where the house prices were actually going to fall down even further. And we're actually using architecture to reimagine the place. So this idea of a public architecture that can actually go into places that are oppressed is really powerful. And commercial architects use it all the time, and that's how they make their value. But actually, we don't use it in the public. We sort of make generic bad public architecture because we say it's about poor people or whatever, and beauty somehow is not for poor people, which I find so offensive, that somehow the notion of beauty is only the right of those with or have. For me, it has to be equalized. It has to be done with the same intensity, whatever it is. And for me, it is not about the material that makes the beauty. It's about the attitude to the material. The attitude to the material can transform either, you know, terrible plywood or corrugated card, or actually can make a, you know, travertine building look terrible. You know, depending on how badly the attitude is. I've seen some very expensive buildings which are really quite bad. So you know, for me, this is a kind of transformation. And for me, sustainability is very much about the life cycle of architecture, that you make an architecture that the community creates a relationship with. How do you make an architecture that makes a relationship with the community? Is a tough one. It's an eternal chicken and egg. But I think it's the debate. It's the debate, and it's about the way in which the community is brought in. It's about the way in which the references and the discussions about the place are debated. It's not necessarily about simplistic things that are thrown in. It's not about tokenistic sort of gestures, but it's about bringing in, you know, whenever we make these complex buildings, we actually talk to the community about what we're trying to do. Like when we're doing the libraries, I showed all the references that I use. I didn't sort of hide them. They weren't sort of, I talked about certain kind of structuralist things. We talked about the ideas, and actually when you open up to the public in a very open and honest way, not in a way to try and dumb them, you know, to speak down at them, they're actually very interested in what you do. What I found is that the public is very interested in what architecture really is, not the simplification of architecture. They want to know about the complexity of architecture and what we're struggling with. And I think that that debate in community creates ownership. All the public buildings that I make have that debate, and the community, you know, I have the, you know, the kids can actually talk about their buildings. I mean, we actually on one of those libraries sponsored a few kids in the neighborhood to just monitor and photograph the entire construction process. So that was sort of the thing that we set up. We said, look, we have this incredible opportunity. We're going to build a public building in your area. You know, which of the kids in these schools would like to have a commission to come through our office and site hut every month and take the picture that they want to take? And they made their own books. And so they can talk about the buildings in ways that not even people in the neighborhood can talk about it. So it's about creating those dialogues and those relationships. We've sort of forgotten that art form, which is actually part of our practice. Yeah.
Which is part of your sense of this idea of creating ownership, right? Yeah. If something has a distinctive look and feel, and if somebody knows something about it, then it's home in a way that's particular, which eludes so much of public architecture, I think, that idea of the mystery, the blankness, which is a combination of the form and the interaction.
Completely.
Strategically.
Completely. Strategically, that's all it is. It is, you know, I really feel that actually in the end, the public isn't necessarily interested in telling you what they what it should look like. They only are interested in that when you're not trying to tell them what it's about. Yeah. Yeah. I find it's when it's opaque, there's a kind of, I'll tell you what I think it should be. No, it's just a piece of public detritus.
See, his buildings are so good, they make trash look like art.
It was just a bad sidewalk. I know, I've seen that image.
Architect.
I've had people, and there's actually a sign on the side of the building that people think it's part of this company. No, it's just.
But actually, that's not an interesting comment, because it's this question of framing.
It's framing.
How something looks in a particular thing. We know about contemporary art, anything can look interesting in that frame, and it's part about the framing. In Johannesburg, you're renovating a building, and then you have a new master plan.
Yeah, in Johannesburg, I'm sort of remaking a tower, a 1950s tower, which was an important building for the diamond cutting industry, and we're turning it into a new sort of residential complex. And in Lagos, we've just finished a new sort of retail public space project that's called Alara, which is just finishing. But what's interesting about Africa for me is that, and it has a kind of sense of California in the 50s, you know, there's this incredible sense of opportunity to do very extraordinary work in very extraordinary climates, and to experiment with, you know, the continent has these six extraordinary climates, so you can actually make very experimental architecture in Africa right now with this emerging new sort of middle class that's kind of coming. So I'm very fascinated by that, but also because there's been so much stagnation sort of post-war, there was an incredible period of master planning sort of during the nation building period, 50s, 60s, 70s. It stopped with the sort of oil crash and all that sort of stuff. And, you know, it's taken 30 years, but now it's restarting. So there's a renewed sense of what master planning now means. And of course, it's not the old idea of master planning. It's this new way of looking at master planning where my office has become very interested in working in what we're calling sort of master planning, which sets up sustainable sort of goals. But it's not about kind of building the city in sort of increments, but about using architecture to strategically activate the sense of how you make a community. So in a way, you plan, and you almost strategically pinpoint the critical public pieces of building, and you almost build them straight away. At the same time, you're building the infrastructure, and you allow that to start to generate the city. And it's something that we're working on in Gabon, in Uganda, in Rwanda. Yeah.
And are you reincorporating some of that older city, the planning
Completely.
Into the new work, right?
Well, there's a whole discussion about conservation, which has not existed in Africa because, you know, you're trying to just make your economies work. But there's this incredible heritage that I, you know, and several of us are talking about, that actually the heritage needs to be a kind of conservation program, which is not just about preserving it, but about also understanding how to reuse that and how to kind of understand how to use that. And it's a very sensitive topic in Africa, because the colonial project is really deeply problematic for a lot of African nations, and they try to just tear it down and get rid of it. But now there's a kind of renewed sense of a kind of much more eclectic sense of understanding that it is the collective history that you heal from, not the tabula rasa and the remaking. So how do you incorporate these things that are sometimes with your tyranny, you know, in South Africa, it's a big topic. And how do you also talk about the modernity and the new nation? So fascinating urbanism discussions. Yeah. I had a wonderful, you know, I was taught by Peter Smithson. I don't know if you know Peter Smithson here, but Peter Smithson is an architect who said, you know, it's very important. Your first work defines how you are. And if you learn the lessons from your first work, it should guide you right to the end. So in a way, I'm continually trying to learn from what exactly I did at the beginning. Because in a way, I did a lot of things that were intuitive but felt true, and I really believed in them, and I'm unpacking those things. But in a way, the scale doesn't matter, and the size doesn't matter. It's the principle of what the work is. And, you know, the office has got quite large, but there's a central message. You know, there aren't five architects designing. I'm the design lead, and I design all the projects. If I can't design it, we don't do it. So we only do as much as I'm capable of doing. So it's a practice that is about a studio evolution. Because in a way, I also believe that the information that's being learned is being brought through and being evolved. The projects, the practice is growing, not in terms of economics or people, but in terms of its capability to deploy the kind of learning in new conditions. And that requires a certain kind of consistency of concentration, which is a very different kind of practice to a commercial one, which is offering styles and opportunities. So that consistency allows you to keep your philosophy, because the philosophy has to be, it's the thing that's guiding the work. It's the next one comes from the last one. It's not the style of it, it's the philosophy of it.
And it's worth saying, I think, that the idea of big is bad and small is good is not true, because you found that at one point, to even survive to make public projects and libraries and things that we've seen, you had to get big enough just to survive. And I think there's that lack of complex understanding in the ethics of that commercial is one thing, but also scale provides opportunity and learning and sustainability. And I think it's something for young architects to know, because I think there's black and white sometimes about that.
There's a sense that
the small
office is the only way. I mean, small offices are great, but they offer a certain level of learning. And with the way in which the world is and the complexity of how buildings are made, if you want to kind of enter the public realm or enter scale,
No one's going to commission a public housing project from a small firm.
No,
so
it needs a certain kind of criticality. So, you know, that the growth has been about that, about targeting the opportunity and saying what scale do we need to be and what expertise do we need to have, not about opportunity. Opportunity is the least interesting part of it.
Architects that you admire.
Oh, I admire a lot of dead ones.
I saw a lot in the slides. Yeah. Architects you admire. I could list them for you.
Yeah. I mean, you know, from Jeffrey Bauer in Sri Lanka to Luis Barragán, just in Mexico, to Oscar Niemeyer in Brazil, to even to Kenzo Tange in Japan, Hassan Fati in Egypt. It keeps going. I can keep going. Does that give you a clue of my spectrum?
I think there is a generosity. You tend to absorb a lot, both present and past.
Yes,
and
I
there
do.
Doesn't seem to be a conflict in that. One of the things I think that's true about architects of a previous generation is there was a different notion of originality as this absolute, this creating a style that would be original and recognized. Mm. And I think in your generation,
we don't have
it. Just that's not quite the interest.
No, it's not about the sort of new singularity, I call it, the singularities. It's much more about complex. Sometimes I'm very interested in remaking things.
Yeah.
But not literally, but I'm literally sometimes very interested in the remaking of the spirit of a project that I really have a big affection to, and to understand how it can be remade in the 21st century. It's never literal. It's like, okay, what is the value of a Lino Barbardi center now, you know, in São Paulo, who is another person I really love? Actually, the artist collaboration.
So any particular
freedoms
or challenges in working with artists.
Yeah, there's this myth that somehow when you work with artists, they give you more freedom or something. It's actually the reverse.
It's the
Don't
reverse.
Ever believe
I can tell you that.
The artists are tougher. It's tougher because they're very specific. But I really love that dialogue with artists, because I think architects should engage with contemporary artists because they're so opinionated. And it's a kind of incredibly powerful moment to question your own assumptions about what things are And to also then to kind of have a dialogue back. So all the people that I've collaborated with absolutely have been ruthless about questioning everything that I assume. And that's been very sort of refreshing for me. It's sort of like a great douche to like cleanse you of all your assumptions. And then you sort of go through it much more clearly about why that's important and why it's not. Not simply because it's beautiful or it's because it's architecture. It's like, why that? So I actually love that. It's a kind of slightly masochistic tendency to work with artists, to pit yourself with artists to kind of
maybe
have that struggle.
Two more questions. We had one here and then one in the way back.
Yes, that's deliberate too. That's totally deliberate.
That may be too long to repeat in its totality, but maybe you could repeat some of it in your answer about the Marion Goodman space and that the entryway and the darkness of the stone.
Yeah.
And
no, I mean, the darkness of the stone is really this, you know, this moment of creating a threshold. You come straight off the street, and when I was talking to Miriam about it, we talked about this idea of, you know, a sort of respite, a threshold respite. And the art space is usually a kind of luminous white box that you know, the minute you open the door, bang, you're in, like, get your stuff going. Do you know what you're looking at? And it was to create a generosity. So it's actually basalt, which is really soft on the eye. It's an incredible, incredible material. And it creates a kind of moment where, and it's the moment where the section opens, which sort of tells you about the upper space, the lowest. You sort of see the entire project, and then you're invited to kind of get serious. It's the threshold.
Yeah. And it does that same thing of darkening to open light. Okay, last question, way in the back.
Yeah, no, we're very sensitive about budget. We always want to know exactly what we're dealing with, and what we want to then know is what something that I've become very meticulous about is what is possible within those budgets, and you know, there's the kind of ordinary thing that's available, and then what is the potential of bending or changing things becomes the experiment that we're always checking. We're sort of, if you come to my office, there's just a billion materials always lining the kind of corridors and the walls, because we're always testing what is available and what is the possibility of it. Not just because of its newness, but what is the performance that we can kind of work with. And we're always trying to find techniques that are loose enough to allow us to try and be able to bend them to do what we would like to achieve in a project.
Thank you all for being here. Thank you so much, David, for your time and your ideas. Thank you.